So that's sort of one piece of information. One of the only pieces of information you have about the low energy structure of the state beyond the order of magnitude. So the sort of canonical theoretical approach that's used is studying the seismic cadet model. Much as today, this bond-dependent kinetic chain plus the isotropic Heisenberg. Physically, as I noted, you could get this from an oxygen-mediated path for going to the oxygen between the orbitals. This J can be generated from some direct exchange between the orbitals. And the phase diagram model is studied extensively. That's, again, you've already seen today, quickly. So there's sort of five phases. There's this kinetic liquid, which survives finite Heisenberg coupling. There's a large anti-ferromagnetic phase, and a large ferromagnetic phase near the anti-ferromagnetic Heisenberg and ferromagnetic Heisenberg limits. And as well, there's the strikey phase and the zigzag phase that appear once that appear next to the kinetic phase when you have finite space. So you see that there is a zigzag phase in that phase diagram, at least somewhere. Do the properties of that phase, ignoring how we got to that point in the phase diagram, agree with the properties of the material? So you could look at the precipitation spectrum to try to figure this out. So if you do a sort of semi-classical calculation, one over n type treatment of the expectation, you find that there is low energy expectation even in this highly anisotropic model. This is essentially due to some accidental classical degeneracy in the Heisenberg cadet model. But you're still stuck with this fact that this cadet coupling needs to be on the positive side, near the anti-ferromagnetic cadet limit. So from this oxygen-mediated type argument, you expect the coupling to be negative. And ab initio studies have sort of been very consistent with that recently. So what's going on here? So there have been some proposed solutions to this, many by at least five people in the audience, where you can, for example, put the sign of K by adding additional exchange paths at various types of primary neighbor coupling, either Heisenberg or, as we heard earlier, from Gaia's second neighbor Kadaev. You can include monoclinic distortions, or you can actually include all of them, all at once. I might have missed some, but that's at least a handful of proposals that can solve this problem. So let's sort of look at this in general and say, what's the sort of couplings that are allowed in this material? So realistically, the structure has both monoclinic and trigonal distortions, and you might expect second and even third neighbor couplings to work. So if you just look at each bond, for example, the nearest neighbor bond, there are four symmetry ladder changes. And because of monoclinic distortion, this bond is slightly different from this bond, and so there's actually another six exchanges allowed on that bond. So that nearest neighbor already has 10 symmetry ladder changes. Now we start doing second and third, ignoring monoclinic distortions, we had at least another 8. So, there are people, some of the audience are brave enough to study this full model with all 20 or so symmetry ladder exchanges. I'm going to sort of back away from that very, very difficult question and just try to look at the simplest possible concept. So what's the simplest consistent model we can write down? And then sort of throw these questions out. Can one find a zigzag phase near the ferromagnetic cadet limit? And with these anisotropic interactions, can you understand why there might be these low energies in it? So the simplest thing we can come up with is we remove all the monoclinic distortion, remove all the trigonal distortion, we remove all the further neighbor coupling. We look at the nearest neighbor model alone without any distortion. As I mentioned in the previous talk, if you do this, a lot of terms are this JK gamma model, this Heisenberg cadet gamma model, where we have the Heisenberg coupling and the cadet coupling we saw before, but we also have the symmetric off-diagonal exchange.
Structure of this, so the cadet bond, for example, here the z components of the spins are coupled, and then for this gamma term, it's the x and the y that are coupled on this bond, cyclically commuted. So within the super exchange calculation, once you include the E hopping as well as the oxygen mediated hopping, you generate this CE. Essentially, you go through the oxygen one way and then back to the orbital. So it's a cross term between direct BD hopping and this oxygen mediated hopping. So I just want to emphasize that even without the distortion, this is not Heisenberg cadet. Okay, so what does this do? So I sort of organized this into a similar phase diagram as you saw in the last talk, where what I put is the Heisenberg cadet model on the outside of this ring. And then as you move in, you're turning on this gamma term. Okay, so in addition to all the phases we saw in the Heisenberg cadet limit, there's actually two new sets of phases. So there's this 120 degree order, which is sort of reminiscent of something you might see on the triangular lattice, except sort of on both of the sublattices of the honeycomb. There's a new zigzag region here that comes in for large gamma, and there are incommensurate spiral orders that appear near the ferromagnetic limit. So this is all classical. So what are these measured phases? I sort of labeled them kind of roughly here. This one region just means that the dominant wave vector of the state is in the first brain zone. Two means it's in the extended brain zone. So this dominant wave vector changes as you move through the phases somewhat smoothly. They're not single Q states, so I'm not sure if I want to call them multi Q, but they're definitely not single Q spiral states. And this phase one is actually quite energetic and close to the six vector. Okay, so again, these are highly quantum mechanical systems. If there's any of this hold up, they try to look whether quantum effects could be important here. In a sort of a small scale exact diagonalization study, 24 sites. So you can capture essentially everything except the spiral order in a cluster of that size. The 120 fits, the zigzag fits, the stripey fits. And so you can see those clearly here, where I've colored the space diagram based essentially on the dominant part of the static structure factor. So here you can see this sort of tiny cadet phase here where the liquid is a little bit stable with the addition of the A and gamma. A little bit wider here, but it's unclear whether it survives too much with finite gamma. Where in the middle here, it's unclear at all what the case is. So classically, this is the same region where there's an independent spiral, so if we're talking about a 24-site cluster, it's unclear whether we can really capture that property at any point. Okay, so in principle, I sort of failed, right? I told you I want to find a zigzag phase here that starts like getting the end limit by looking at the system model, and all I found were incommensurate spirals. So let's go to the next simplest model. So one could even principle add monoclinic distortion, trigonal distortion, further neighbor coupling. I'm not trigonal distortion. So in the crystal structure, the sodium has a trigonal compression out of the plane. If you go through this, you can find that it introduces a single nearest neighbor coupling in addition to the three you already had. So it's sort of a cousin of this symmetric off diagonal exchange. Instead of the, for example, on the Z bond, instead of X and Y coupling, you have X and Z coupling and Y and Z coupling. And if you do sort of a rough microscopic calculation of this, for trigonal compression, you might expect it to be negative. So I'm sort of going to focus on adding a negative gamma prime when thinking about this sodium irritation. Okay, so what does that do? So classically, as I told you before, the zigzag phase and this one spiral phase are actually quite close in energy. And it turns out adding this negative gamma prime actually tips the balance towards the zigzag phase. So this one phase that occurred here is almost completely overtaken by zigzag. So this is actually quite a small gamma prime. It's maybe a 20th of K, and it just completely enlarges this phase and brings it down almost to this ferromagnetic depth. Again, you might ask, how does this hold up away from the classical limit? I've sort of changed the phase diagram, but here, in the middle of these plots is the cadet limit here. Gamma goes up, and then J is running along the x-axis, and each slice is a different value of gamma prime. So here you see this mess that we saw in the exact diagonalization that I associated with maybe the stripy phase classically. And as I turn on a negative gamma prime, you see the zigzag correlation starting to come. So this is consistent with the expectations from the classical calculation. Okay, so we sort of partially answered one of the questions. Can we find a zigzag phase within the simple model, or second simplest model, close to the ferromagnetic depth limit? So it seems like we can. Can we explain why this energy scale and this energy phase is so small? So in these highly anisotropic models, you don't really expect to find things like Goldstone. unless you have a classical generic you'd like to say to came on. So generically, you would expect this, as soon as you include this gamma or this gamma prime, you would start opening up gaps in spin waves, make them significant, you know, greater than 1 or 2 MeV, you wouldn't have these low energy excitations. And microscopically, it's not